Rivers and deltas are key systems that form the arteries of the earth, supporting the life and welfare of billions of people. River systems and their deltas have always been attractive to humans for settlement because of the water, fertile soils, and transport opportunities they provide. Today, these systems are under enormous pressure because of human interventions in the system. If we go on the business as usual scenario, we know the quality of rivers and deltas will continue to deteriorate by 2050. The good news is that we can bend the trend. River and delta systems are linked to most sustainable development goals. Flooding, for example, has an effect on many SDGs. There are several ways to reduce the risks related to flooding. In this example, three measures can be selected. Adjusting the protection standards to climate change, but not to socio-economic changes, would mean an increase in exposure by 65%. This is the low ambition pathway in the flood risk example. As flood risk still greatly increases due to socio-economic developments, there is little or no contribution to other SDGs, which is reflected in the general very low protection levels in many regions of the world. The high ambition pathway assumes protection of rural areas against a once-in-a-100-year flood, and an even higher level of flood protection against a once-in-a-1,000-year flood for urban areas. This pathway contributes very positively to most SDGs. From global to local, collaborating actors may be inspired to work on a meaningful elaboration of SDGs, thus building a shared language and understanding of sustainable development. Linking the post-COVID-19 recovery agenda to the mid-term sustainability agenda and the long-term climate agenda is a win-win strategy, thereby avoiding old school projects that will set us back in time.
Dear viewers, welcome to the session on sustainable rivers and deltas of tomorrow. You just saw a small appetizer of what we call our River Basins and Delta tool. A tool which we have published today as part of a larger project carried along by PBL, the Netherlands Environmental Assessment Agency, as part of its Geography of Future Water Challenges program. My name is Hans Mommaas. I'm the Director General of PBL. And I'm sitting here on behalf of our water adaptation team led by Willem Lichtvoet and Arno Bouwman. In this session, we want to elaborate on the issue of the future sustainability of river and delta systems and on how such a knowledge tool might be able to help in creating effective action programs in order to make these river delta systems future-proof. As the latest Adaptation Gap report of UNEP points out, we need to scale up and intensify the global adaptation program to make sure that we meet the promises we made to each other in the 2015 Paris Agreement. Partly that's about taking wise decisions about where to invest in. And partly it's about taking an integrated perspective on things to maximize results. Partly it's about being able to compare action programs and learn from them. In this small session, we want to talk about these points. I will be moderating this session together with Henk Ovink, sitting here next to me at a COVID-safe distance. Henk is the Netherlands Special Envoy for International Water Affairs. And via Zoom, we will be joined by Monica Scatasta, working at the Council of Europe Development Bank as Director of the Technical Assessment and Monitoring Directorate. And by Jennifer John, from the Stockholm International Water Institute, working there as Program Manager of International Policy. And last, Maria Sotomayor, working at the World Bank as Practice Manager for the Africa region. This session is organized by both PBL and the Dutch Ministry of Infrastructure and Water Management. Henk, let's start with the complexity of these river delta systems and the challenges they are faced with and how we might turn those challenges into an opportunity. Because complex they are.
Yes.
Not just as ecosystems, they have very different sort of water dynamics and sedimentation dynamics. They have very different links to economic circumstances. Some of them are rich fishing and agricultural grounds. Some of them carry along a vast fossil-based transportation and manufacturing infrastructure. They link mountains thousands of miles away with seas and oceans. So they're very complex. And when you start to think about them, it's not just about adaptation. It's about mitigation. It's about urbanization processes. It's about decarbonizing fossil-based economies. They're facing challenges in relation to climate change. So, you know, you can be overwhelmed by this complexity. You've been traveling the world. You've seen a lot of these challenges and how they're tackled by local municipalities, by governments, national governments, companies. How can we turn this complexity from a stumbling block, piling up ambitions and ambitions, to an opportunity?
Right. Thank you, Hans. And it's great to have you here do this session with you on river basins and the tool as part of the program we do together on the geography of future water challenges.
Yep.
And it's exactly this complexity that is the opportunity. What we see often, too often in practice, is that we zoom in and we take a siloed approach, often based on a vested interest or an interest by a singular voice, a singular player. And then those solutions create negative impacts across all these development goals. So only by stepping back a little and looking across the 2030 agenda, so looking at all these development goals, cultural, environmental, economic, as well as social, humanitarian, and taking climate into account, you see the links. And in these links, these interlinkages, you can help drive sustainable development. So you could say an integrated, holistic approach enables us, you know, as organizations to come up with the right solutions. Second, the complexity also increases the table of the partners. So because it is not only about agriculture or economy or a river or water and sanitation or transboundary issues alone, because you increase the table of partners that come from all these different backgrounds, you also increase the opportunity to come up with solutions that create added value. Third, it demands a bit of patience and time. Yeah? You can't come up with the easy fixes. Those easy fixes will create immediate negative impacts on the short term. So it means that you have to invest in this process of, one, understanding the complexity. Don't be afraid, but really understand it. Second, start to create value across these different aspects, and as we say, across all these development goals. Mm-hmm. And then third, start to organize and manage it. And then you can do it on all levels. Because from that complexity and the whole river basin scale, you can identify interventions for each and every one of those stakeholders. So the complexity is actually the opportunity for a sustainable pathway forward.
Yeah, because it gives you the space to move around.
Yeah.
It gives you the space to look for co-benefits. It gives you the space to look for stakeholders, alliances.
And no one can escape. The moment if you take just the pie from the chart, then you're lost.
Yeah. But is there a natural starting point somewhere?
Well, the river basin itself, of course, stands for so much of our society, and it really helps bringing stakeholders together because everybody is dependent on that same water.
Yeah.
And investing in that water has a trickle-down effect on all these stakeholders, SDGs, and interests.
Yeah.
So I think the basin helps. And what I experience around the world is it doesn't always work starting from the biggest scale. You can start sometimes in an urban context where people, organizations, institutions are already organized together, being part of such a larger system. But you have to find the opportunity to zoom in and zoom out. And then with the interventions you create, those are opportunities to be scaled up. Eh? You need these type of innovations that inspire, bring investors and policymakers and industry as well as NGOs and individuals to the table. Say, there's something we can do. What we must do is also something we have to show that we can do.
But it needs boundary work.
Yeah. And you have to span these boundaries. And I think, part of the work from the Environmental Assessment Agency, the Dutch Environmental Assessment, and your work is creating enough space for spanning that boundary, but also helping spanning those boundaries. Part of my work as a diplomat is creating that other space of the conversation in spanning those boundaries. And with planners, for instance, and designers or innovators and industries, we can create the right incentives that actually, when we span these boundaries in the space we create that is soft and safe, that we can move ahead.
But you've been traveling around. You've seen a lot of these projects. There is no blueprint.
No. Every place, it's different. When I work, for instance, in India and Chennai, we start very small with this, out of this full water landscape assessment where we have everything in place and we know actually what could work. We still, based on the political, societal, and economic conditions, start very small on a school with the school in the schoolyard and create the incentive to, from one, create 10 and then 100 projects across the city that can help create, build that sustainable development. Yeah. But in Bangladesh, you have to start totally different. You take a systems approach with these large riverine systems. And in Vietnam, we go transboundary. So you work in different contexts, in different scales and levels, and you have to tailor it and invest in tailoring that too.
In this session, we will be looking at three points.
Yeah.
One is finance. One will be the analytical tool with which we look at these projects. And one will be about local stakeholdership.
Yeah.
What about finance?
Well, what about finance? There's a part of finance that is about creating value.
Yeah.
Because you want to return what you put in. And the challenge here is, again, the intervention. If the intervention is siloed or stupid, then often the return is short term and only one partner often benefits. Take a road, it always creates economic development and opportunities, but it kills biodiversity, more CO2 emissions, and from a social and humanitarian point of view, often a disaster.
Yeah.
So finance from a single point perspective is only short-term gains. But if you start to create the opportunity of looking at values, then you can see investing in that water space creates value with better health, better opportunities, better economic development, better sustainability, mitigating climate, both the risk as well as the change.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, but that demands, again, next to focusing on value, that you create the opportunity for a fund structure or another type of financial mechanism where other partners can come in that take the risks on the short term and capture the benefits on the longer term.
Okay, let's turn to Monica Scatasta from the Council of Europe Development Bank. Monica, when we were preparing this session, you sent us an email, in which you remarked that you perhaps had some sobering remarks to make about the integrated role or long-term role of finance. What about the role of finance? Could you reflect on it, also in the context of what Henk was saying here, that we should have to turn from a short-term perspective in finance to a long-term perspective, with finance also coming out of its silo perspective?
Absolutely. Well, I hope I'm not going to only have some sobering remarks, but a mix of what we can do, what we're already doing, and some of the challenges ahead. And when I think of the challenges ahead, I'm an extremely ambitious person in terms of what I would like us to do. So maybe my sobering remarks is because I think we can do even more. So finance is a variegated, let's say, concept and family. CEB, so Council of Europe Development Bank, like the World Bank, it was also on this panel, a multilateral development bank, actually the oldest in Europe, 65 years old this year. And already we see what Hank was saying earlier about the importance of focusing on a multiplicity of development objectives. Let's take just the CEB and its mandate as the Social Development Bank of Europe. When we look at our mandate, we look at inclusive growth, social cohesion, social inclusion, support for vulnerable groups, and environmental sustainability, and increasingly a focus on climate action. So we look at the interactions between social and environmental goals, and this is what the family of MDBs has been doing for a very long time. Mm. What, therefore, the MDBs can do, the multilateral development banks and the international financial institutions have been doing quite well, is what Henk was saying earlier, i.e. to focus on value, to look at the long term, to be patient, to be the patient finance that can help support those investments that may not have necessarily a very high financial return, but they can create value in an economy, and especially address market failures by financing projects that indeed have high social and environmental returns. Now, the issue is that our direct financing per se and alone will not do it. The question is, how do we bring more private finance into this space? How do we bring more private finance to support the social and environmental objectives, and how do we bring them into the water space in particular? And here it's about the capacity of international financial institutions to also reduce perceived risk in investment in water, in investment in areas that create value at the social, economic, and environmental levels. The issue, however, is that this can be done when it is possible also for a counterpart that can receive finance to be identified. The river basin is a fantastic locus in terms of analysis, mm-hmm. and understanding of the complexities. It is a difficult counterpart when it comes to financing, apart from certain countries where this is possible. And I'm thinking about France, I'm thinking about the Netherlands, and I'm thinking about a number of others, but in some places this is not possible. So the entry point for financing is difficult. It can be national, it can be local, but the geographical scale of where the problems and the solutions are may not be the same as the geographical scale of the decision making on the one hand and of the receiving entity for financing on the other. These are challenges that we've been facing for a very long time. Another aspect that leads to finance being focused very often on the short run, you were saying short run versus long run, or focusing more on immediate financial returns. We haven't been very good in the finance profession, now I'm talking in general, at factoring in climate-related, environmental-related risks in properly assessing them, managing them, and reporting on them. Clearly, the CFD, the task force on climate-related financial disclosure, and now, hopefully this year, the launch also of TNFD, so the task force on nature-based financial disclosure, is that these efforts are really helping the financial regulators, the network, in particular the network for greening the financial system and GFS, and the regulators therein, are calling for more better assessment of climate-related and environmental-related risks on the part also of private financial institutions. The ECB really paving the way, calling for looking incorporation of climate risk in stress testing as of 2022. So we're really seeing a shift. We're really seeing a shift also in private finance in the incorporation of these aspects. However, water specific, my sobering remarks. The problem is that very often this complexity and the need to bring to the same table many different actors at different level of governance has not served as well in terms of being able then to either plan in a way that brings all of the voices to the table. It takes a long time, and therefore patient finance can be there and accompany this process, but not all financial actors can do that. And also the fact of the difficulty of understanding where the benefits accrue, and the fact of having a multiplicity of benefits in different areas sometimes plays at a disadvantage. And I'm thinking of a strange example maybe, but we talk about co-benefits a lot, right? Also in the climate space, the fact that, for instance, we have in with a water investment also climate adaptation benefits. This sometimes, the fact that it is also, that it's not only, has played against the selection of water projects in some multilateral financial institutions that were striving to augment their climate finance in terms of the climate finance volumes, mm-hmm. because other projects would deliver higher percentages of climate finance compared to the water projects. These internal strange logics of financial institutions can sometimes play against the prioritization of the type of investment with multiple benefits, with benefits across large scales and for different groups in a region that we see in the water sector. There's a light at the end of the tunnel, of course. There's always been. And indeed, if I think, again, an example of ways in which our financial institutions have shown the capacity to be to support countries and counterparties and be the patient's finance and the patient and the long-term partner. We have Maria Angelica here, so it's a project that we co-finance with the World Bank. I'm thinking of the two projects, in fact. In the Odra first and Odra Vistula for flood risk management. We started back in 2007. We've been supporting this long-term endeavor for many, many years, and we're not done yet. Mm-hmm. We're starting to see the benefits, but it takes patience. It takes a lot of dialogue also with local communities, including those that may oppose certain projects. And it takes also time to make the approaches evolve to incorporate more nature-based solutions and other types of solutions. Basically, there are a number of entities that really can make a difference. More and more, the development also in terms of private finance are bringing more finance into the sustainability space. Not fast enough, maybe, but we have very good examples, and we can continue along those lines.
Thank you. Could I just because you mentioned various elements which I think could be elaborated, but I want to pick out two of them. One is the demand for something of coherence in the planning. Because you want to know where to invest in, where the return of investment comes from. You want to have some sort of negotiation about gains and costs, etc., which demands for something of an integrated framework to be able to analyze these vast ecosystems in their also economic and social circumstances. That would be the moment where I think Jennifer John could jump in. Because from the Stockholm Institute, Jennifer, could I ask you to talk a bit about the role of analytical tools in delivering the kind of coherence that Monica is asking for?
Wonderful, happy to. Thank you so much for inviting Siwi to speak at this virtual table. I want to maybe begin with adding congratulations on the River Basin Delta tool, which integrates so innovatively and so intuitively one of, I think, the best global action and global mobilization tools we have on hand, and that is the 17 Sustainable Development Goals. I say that because the SDGs give us a common language to be able to identify the biggest challenges we face mm-hmm. and perhaps some of the most wicked problems mm-hmm. We face as a global community, and to use that common language to prioritize where and how we need to respond to this problem so that we can bring about a global transformation by 2030. And it's really a remarkable organizing principle. It has organized and reorganized constellations of action at the local, regional, and global levels, across boundaries, across sectors. Just to add a personal touch, my own personal introduction to the SDGs was when I was working for a small but really courageous German foundation that made a bold decision to align all of their activities with the SDG framework. Mm-hmm. It was about being strategic as an institution. It was about connecting to the global level, coordinating with others, building partnerships, and perhaps most importantly, monitoring, measuring, and communicating impact. Yeah. So it makes a lot of sense that the River Basin Delta tool utilizes the SDG framework and joins this global ecosystem of actors, change makers, to bring about impactful and sustainable solutions to the ecological, economical challenges affecting rivers and deltas and the billions of us that who depend on them. I think the next great task is to use this common language that we have to tap into synergies. And this speaks to a lot of the themes that Henk and Monica already mentioned. Mm-hmm. In 2015, along with the Sustainable Development Agenda, we had two other major global agendas that the global community produced based on consensus, and that was the Paris Agreement and the Sendai Framework for Disaster Risk Reduction. These agreements gave countries and non-state actors a global framework to make commitments and to agree on shared targets to be reached together. They provided the manual, if you will, for driving not only actions at the national and local levels, but also an architecture for global cooperation yeah. and global discussions on how we transform our world yeah. into a more sustainable and resilient future that leaves no one behind. These frameworks are also tools that should enable countries and UN agencies, as well as international intergovernmental organizations and donors, to invest, monitor, and evaluate impact with a common process and increased efficiency. Mm-hmm. And so the common kind of thread in each of these frameworks is that by working collectively in the same direction, we should be able to accelerate progress and deliver good, high-quality impact. Mm-hmm. That said, the reality is very different. Unfortunately, countries have ended up with a very sectoral, siloed way of engaging with these frameworks. And, you know, one of the ways that we can see this is in the voluntary national reviews of the SDGs. Mm-hmm. The 2019 IPCC Special Report on the Ocean and the Cryosphere also points to this problem of fragmented governance. There is not enough discussion of the interconnections between the SDGs and across these other global agendas. In kind of UN speak, we talk about co-benefits and trade-offs. We don't give enough thought to them. So when it comes to water, water governance and water management are mainly addressed when SDG 6 is being highlighted. Mm-hmm. But we have to bear in mind that there are water-related targets that exist in many of the other SDGs. They are hardly mentioned during the something called the High-Level Political Forum when the VNRs are submitted and reviewed. Therefore, the transformative and integrated approach that needs to be reached to implement on these goals is not sufficiently taken. And when that happens, we lose the really extraordinary power that water has to mm-hmm. power the 2030 agenda and to contribute to both adaptation and mitigation goals in service of the Paris Agreement. We have to strive to implement this new interconnected paradigm. Yeah. And we have to escape the silos, and we really have to see ourselves as bridge makers. We have to invest in capacity building and new governance processes and mechanisms, and build more ambitious and comprehensive solutions. And, you know, as Henk alluded to, we have to take the time to dialogue with one another, build trust, and address the different trade-offs and co-benefits that can arise from a more integrated and holistic approach. In the context of rivers, deltas, and estuaries, as shown in the video that we saw earlier, I can add that during the segment on water for the Climate Adaptation Summit, Peter Thompson, the UN Special Envoy for Oceans, refers to the need of for a source-to-sea ethos. When he spoke at the opening of World Water Week, he made a compelling case for the blue trinity that exists at the crossroads of SDG 6, and 13 on climate and 14 on oceans, highlighting that there's no healthy planet without healthy oceans. And this relies mainly on the activities that are land-based, the pollutants that are dumped through solid and liquid waste into oceans, seas, mangroves, estuaries, rivers, wetlands. So we cannot implement sustainable solutions if we don't look at the interconnectedness of our Earth system. And as we all know, the hydrological cycle, the water cycle, is one of the most sophisticated and elaborate systems that we have. Yeah. So it can inspire so much of the circular economy thinking, the interconnected thinking. And we need to definitely take more fully into account the water, water's connections to our societal, environmental, and economic needs. Mm-hmm. I'll finish with two images.
Yep.
The first one is what we normally see when we talk about SDGs. It's this kind of just, you know, a list of the various SDGs that we have. Mm-hmm. And we see them, you know, next to each other. And this doesn't necessarily convey any sense that they are linked to one another. So what I would prefer is a second image that you see on the screen. This is something that is called the wedding cake of the SDGs. This shows that at the foundation of this wedding cake, we have the SDG 6, 13, 14, and 15, the environmental SDGs that support the societal and economic goals. And this is really the way to look at how we transform the implementation of the various global agendas. We have all of the frameworks we need. And we have brilliant tools like the River Basin Delta tool to connect to the global agendas and give them life. But now what we have to do is to strive to implement the global agendas in an integrated manner. Yep. And we certainly need the financial resources to step up and to support this new paradigm shift. We heard from the Prime Minister of the Netherlands, Prime Minister Rutte, who announced that we need a multi-stakeholder approach. Yep. We need everybody on board to accelerate this progress, and we need that progress across the board.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So a good argument to go beyond the 17 SDGs separately, but look at the interactions between them, something we've also tried in our river and delta tool to do. Looking at conditional SDGs and result SDGs, and I think that's a way to, in a sense, get to an integrated approach, which is also facilitating finance investments, but which might also facilitate stakeholdership. And that's, I think, where we go to Maria Sotomayor. Perhaps you can tell us something about how we can organize integrated local stakeholdership on the ground, and whether these integrated perspectives linked to the SDGs or the planetary boundaries might be of help in getting people together around integrated agendas.
Thank you. Yes, I want to start by highlighting that we live in an unprecedented moment. And that the COVID-19 crisis presents an opportunity to build back better and to try to include those challenges in river basin and delta management that we have discussed today in the future planning and growth of the countries around the world. And we think that we can help countries to prioritize green stimulus spending in a way that will further increase climate resilience and in river basins and coastal zones to avoid things like revenge pollution and further degradation of river basins and coastal zones that we have seen during past periods of rapid economic rebound. And as you are correctly asking in the question, to get us to work in a better direction will require sustained, coordinated approaches in country. Mm-hmm. And how we do this is the biggest challenge. Better river basin and coastal zone management present a collective action problem requiring that different sectors and institutions come together to solve common challenges. And we need common platforms for people to come together to address these challenges. And this requires working through traditional and new means. And I want to talk a bit about some of the specific things that we are doing in around the world. And existing water resources management authorities and river basin organizations can play a critical role in bringing together different water using sectors to work in new ways. For example, through our water resources lending program, we have currently over $10 billion that are working alongside other development partners to help build capacity of national water resources authorities, river basin organizational, national and transboundary organizations, and to bring stakeholders together and engage in joint planning, to monitor the health of river basins, to build capacity, to better regulate the river basin, to invest in the basin from source to sea. And another way, establishment of new platforms that bring together stakeholders around common problems. And we're working with governments in about 10 countries to bring together water using ministries into the platforms to help them to better understand threats to their water security and find ways in which risks to water security can be minimized. We host the 2030 WRG group that works also in multi-stakeholder platforms with the private sector, civil society, and governments. We need to continue expanding those. Another area is helping people to understand the drivers and impacts of water issues. And we often work with governments to conduct water security diagnostics to look at key threats to water security, including at the basin and coastal zone issues, and to prioritize the areas for action and investment. Mm-hmm. We work to increase coordination in planning between entities involved in the basin. Cities, Henk mentioned, water users, the agriculture and others, and coastal zone management, and including sharing common data and information management. And as we all know, we cannot manage what we don't measure. So finding ways for government entities to jointly monitor the river basin and coastal zones resources is a necessary step in better working jointly. And a final point on opportunities is to link water and sanitation issues in large urban areas, particularly those in delta areas, in hotspots, with a circular economy approach and dealing with unplanned settlements, particularly in deltas, and achieving SDG 6 and bringing benefits from others. Finally, I want to mention that in partnership with Deltares, the bank is working on a new flagship study that sets out a vision for how national governments can deal with hydroclimatic risks and challenges through innovative governance. And the report will provide a framework that can help inform decisions regarding laws, institutions, strategic plans, programs, regulations, and critical agency tasks. We have identified that a new approach is required to manage the large and growing risks associated with extreme hydroclimatic events. Globally, floods and droughts mm-hmm. are already the most prevalent natural disasters in terms of the number of people affected. And as we know, this will just be further amplified by climate change. The three overarching governance principles promoted in the report are a whole of society approach to reducing risks, addressing floods and droughts through the same hydroclimatic management prism, and leadership through a joint government response. Mm-hmm. And of course, I just want to finalize by mentioning that all of this is done with the support of our partners who work alongside with us, that provide resources to different trust funds that complement our investments and financing initiatives, including the Dutch, with whom we work very closely in the water sector.
Well, thank you. Thank you for this contribution. Henk, we've just talked for half an hour, a bit more than half an hour, about these ingredients. I think they reflect very nicely what you said in the beginning. You have to jump into the complexity and then see where you can join forces, how you can link investment to local stakeholdership, how you can link analytical tools to wider ecosystems, to explore these ecosystems, to have costs and benefits analysis, et cetera, et cetera. In your experience, yeah, because we're looking for these tools, yeah, we're looking for sort of you've been looking at this river delta tool we've been developing. What should be the next step?
Well, the next step is bring it actively in this process of engagement of actors. And I think this is also part of the conversation, and you need the framework, mm-hmm. the way to assess the multitude of risks and opportunities, mm-hmm. benefits. But at the same time, what we also hear is that it takes time. Yeah. The funny thing about this, spending a lot of money always takes time. If it's on stupid infrastructure or on smart infrastructure, it doesn't really matter. So it's not an excuse to say, oh, it takes time. But it takes time to bring everybody together, bring in these type of tools, methodologies that focus on innovation, like planning and design. And that demands also funding. Yeah. It's not the amount of money needed for the infrastructure. But I always say you need $1 million to spend $1 billion wisely. And so you need to make sure that from an investment point of view and the partnership point of view, there is enough funding to spend in the process. Second, it is also about continuity, consistency, and commitment. And what we see around the world is that we really like to hop around from pilot to pilot. So we do a project in this river basin and then a project there. But these type of approaches, system-based approaches, are rigorously, fundamentally based on consistency, commitment, and continuity. And if we can get that with the stakeholders all involved, then there is an opportunity with such a tool, this river basin tool, that helps us assess risk, helps us assess opportunities, and helps accommodate a process of collaboration towards identifying those interventions that really make a difference.
Yeah. So there is still some work to be done.
Yeah.
But the beginning is there.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Because we have something of the beginning of a common framework and a common language to, in a certain sense, start the learning process or proceed with the learning process, because it's already beginning in a certain sense. Right, I think that's the end of our short exploration of what these river and delta systems are facing up towards the future. I would like to invite everybody to go to the PBL website to have a look at the tool and to also start to use the tool as a resource for starting action programs. Yeah. And I would like to thank you, Henk Ovink. I would like to thank Monica Scatasta, Jennifer Judd, and Marta Sotomayor for your presence here. And with those last words, I give back to our audience. Thank you very much.